Good evening and welcome to St. Peter and St. Paul for our candlelit carol service. I'm Wendy, the Associate Vicar in the parish, and Ben, our vicar, will be speaking to us later in the service. And we are joined by many members of our parish who will be reading and praying and playing and singing this evening. It's great to have you all here with us this evening as we celebrate this season of Advent. We're looking forward to Christmas, I'm sure, and we'll hear more tonight about how Christmas is a blessing for us for the whole of our lives. Now, this evening's service will run this evening unannounced, and all the words you will need will be on the screens this evening. Basically, it's stand to sing, sit for all the rest. So do stand if you are able when it comes to singing. But let me pray as we open our service this evening. Almighty God, however we have come, wherever we have come from, as we gather here this evening to remember and celebrate your coming as a baby, may it be your joy and gladness that fills our hearts and in turn fills this place with the sound of praise from our mouths. May through the candlelight we may be reminded of Jesus, the light of the world, who broke into the darkness. And may each person here tonight know your presence in this place as we remember how you came to be among us as a little baby, the Christ child. Amen. Now, this evening we're going to light our third Advent candle to mark this third Sunday in Advent. The first candle is going to be lit, reminding us of the patriarchs, the second to remember the prophets. And this evening we're going to light the third candle as we remember John the Baptist. He prepared the way for Jesus' first coming 2,000 years ago. They were old, but God gave Zechariah and Elizabeth a son called John. John spoke to the people in the desert, calling them to turn back to God. John the Baptist denied his own comforts and died for what he believed, because he loved people, wanting them to repent and find God's forgiveness. So we're going to light the candles now. Love is like a candle shining in a dark place. As we look at the light of these candles, we celebrate the love that we have in Christ. So let us pray. Lord God, your witness, John the Baptist, grew up strong in spirit, and he prepared people for Jesus' first coming. He loved your people and baptized them in the River Jordan as a sign of their forgiveness for sins. Help us to have that same love, that we would be witnesses of the Lord Jesus and spread the good news of his gospel of forgiveness for sins for all who come to him in repentance and faith. Amen. So now we're going to sing our first carol this evening, so I invite you to stand. O come, Emmanuel.
This evening's first reading is from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 9, and it's verses 2-6. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bars across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and power, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. This is the word of the Lord.
The second reading is taken from Luke chapter 1, verses 46-55. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers. This is the word of the Lord.
Let me add my welcome to Wendy's. As age has crept upon me, my body is showing more signs of it. The hair went ages ago. I'm fighting a losing battle against the waistline. And the latest addition is the glasses. I sort of wonder, how did all that happen? The one benefit is that my wife thinks the glasses suit me, though she didn't go as far as to say attractive. I'll take that as a win, though. The glasses are great. Everything is clearer. They don't change what I'm looking at, the words on the page or the screen. The glasses don't change what I'm looking at. They just make it appear brighter. The glasses magnify so I can see things more clearly. And I want to think for a few moments now about Mary. And although she's just an ordinary girl chosen for an extraordinary job, we don't want to miss the amazing faith, trust, this teenage girl has in God. Mary has been visited by an angel who announces she's pregnant. That's challenging, seeing as she's still a virgin. I have two daughters, and that wouldn't wash with me as their dad. Yet it's true for Mary. Mind-bending as it is for us and for her, she's not stupid. She knows that's not how things work. The angel also tells Mary her relative Elizabeth is going to have a baby. Now, Elizabeth's much older and she can't have children, so there's two baby miracles going on in the early chapter of Luke here. As Mary wonders about her own baby, she goes to visit Elizabeth to see how she's getting on. Could it really all be true? So Mary makes the journey, and a visit to Elizabeth lifts her faith. It strengthens her trust in God, and what the angel said, it really is all true. And so encouraged is Mary that she sings a song, and that's what we've just heard read. It's a song often known by its first word in Latin, the Magnificat. Mary says, my soul glorifies, magnifies the Lord. My soul magnifies the Lord. We've read the whole song, but I just want to focus on the first two lines for a few minutes now, taking a few thoughts from a friend of mine along the way. Nobody can make God any bigger. The Bible tells us that God is the biggest, the greatest. He is eternal, he is everlasting, he made everything from nothing, yet he also knows every single hair on our heads. And for some, that's more than others. But you get the point. Nobody can make God any bigger. But we can see him in a bigger light. God can be magnified to us when we realize who he really is and what he's really done for us. We can magnify God, which is what Mary does. We can move from seeing a tiny little God, if we even believe in God at all, a distant God who isn't really involved and doesn't really care and couldn't really do anything about it if he did. We can move from there to seeing a much greater God who draws close to us, who cares about us more than we can imagine, and who is wonderfully in control of everything. Mary magnifies God after he reveals himself to her. So I've got to ask this evening, what do you make of God? Is he little and inconsequential in your life? You might think about him once a year at a carol service. Or perhaps you have a nice Sunday God. Each week we come to church, but he doesn't really impact much else about our life. And if God isn't that big in our lives, what is? What is big for you? Is it a sports team? Is it your work? Is it a hobby or an interest? Is it friends and family? Is it your social media profile? Because our souls, our minds, our hearts, our spirits, they always magnify something. It's obvious from this song that Mary is passionate about God. She magnifies him. But it could so easily have been different. Think about it. After the angel visits Mary, her soul could have magnified the wrong things. Well, what about her problems? If you know the true Christmas story in the Bible, you'll know that divorce and disgrace were real possibilities for Mary. Mary visits Elizabeth. Elizabeth confirms she's pregnant, at which point Mary might have broken down in despair. We could understand her cry of, "It's really happening. Oh no, what a mess." It's understandably easy for us to magnify the problems in our lives, the things that aren't going how we want them to, the things that cause the heartache and the pain for us. It's easy to understand that Mary might have magnified her problems. Alternatively, Mary might have magnified her privileges. Pride might have crept in. Let's be honest, Mary has been chosen for the highest honor in human history, to be the mother of God's own son. Surely there's some temptation to pride there. And all pride is simply magnifying ourselves, turning up the volume on all we think is great and good about ourselves, our skills and our gifts, our achievements. Now, any of us who are self-aware know that Mary might have magnified her privileges to pride. Yet our reading tells us Mary fixes her sights not on her problems, not on her privileges, but on her passion, God. And Mary rejoices in God. When we fix our sights on God, who the Bible tells us he really is, and what he's really done for us, our problems and privileges, they fade. They don't change. They don't go away, painful and hard as they are. But our perspective on them changes. They are reduced in our perspective, and God is magnified. And when we do that, the whole world appears in the right perspective. Like glasses, we see both our problems and our privileges through the right lenses. Mary is a beautiful example of this. Fix your eyes on what God has done for us. Though you might be sat here now thinking, what reason have I got to magnify God? What's God ever done for me? Your problems may be very real and seem very big at the moment. If God was really worth anything, life wouldn't be like this. Or maybe things are good for you at the moment. You are winning. To be honest, I don't really need God because I'm doing pretty well by myself. I could talk to you for hours about God. In fact, later I'm going to tell you about the chance to find out more about the real hope, real peace, and real purpose for life God promises we can find. But as we finish now, and we're going to finish in a moment, let me give you one teaser to that. If you feel broken and weary with life, or if you feel you've cracked life and you are doing great on your own without God, I want to share one thing God shares with us. A single verse from the Bible that puts God in the right perspective. It puts our problems and our pride in the right perspective. Mary says, "My soul magnifies the Lord." Then she goes on to say, "And my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour." This verse I'm going to show you is the reason she says all of that. John chapter 3, verse 16, we read, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." If your privileges and pride are magnified at the moment, if you think you're doing all right without God, know that we really do all need Jesus. The Bible tells us there is a perishing coldness and darkness we face for living our lives as if we're all good without God. But by believing, by trusting in Jesus, whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. If your privileges and pride are magnified at the moment, if you think you're doing all right without God, know that we really do all need Jesus. And if your problems are magnified at the moment, know that in Jesus, God loves you more than you could ever imagine. Jesus came that first Christmas. He gave up the throne room of heaven for a cold, dark stable, so that through his life, death, and resurrection, the Bible tells us, as we believe, trust in him, we can come in from the darkness and the coldness of being God's enemies to enjoy the glory of heaven as his children. It is a great swap, a great exchange. God loves you so much, he gave up his son so that we can become his sons and daughters. If your problems are magnified at the moment, know that in Jesus, God loves you more than you could ever imagine. I'm going to pray now. Heavenly Father, thank you for Christmas. As we remember that first Christmas, help us to magnify you in our lives. Forgive our pride and our self-centeredness, which so often leads us to magnify our privileges. Forgive our loss of perspective when our problems overwhelm us. May you be the passion of our lives. And may we see how you offer us real hope, real peace, real purpose, now and for eternity, when we turn and trust in Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
Today's reading is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, and from 1 to 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was the governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for their baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The fourth reading is taken from Luke, chapter 2, reading verses 8 to 20. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. you will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the word of the Lord.
We come now to our time of prayer together this evening. And after each short prayer, when I say Jesus Saviour, could you respond with "Hear our prayer"? Jesus Saviour. Christ born in a stable, give courage to all who are homeless and struggling for the necessities of life, both close at home and in places like Gaza and Ukraine. Strengthen and encourage all those working to help them at this time. Jesus, Saviour, hear our prayer. Christ, for whom the angels sang, give the song of the kingdom to all who weep and draw them into your loving arms, that they may know your grace and mercy. We particularly pray for all those known and unknown to us, suffering from poor health, anxiety, bereavement, and in any other way. Jesus, Saviour. Christ, worshipped by the shepherds, give peace on earth to all who are oppressed, and bring those perpetrating war and violence to a knowledge of you and your purposes. Jesus, Saviour. Christ, before whom the wise men knelt, give wisdom and humility to all who govern, that they might work for the good of all people and to your glory, and not their own agendas and ambitions. Jesus, Saviour. Christ, whose radiance filled a lowly manger, give the glory of your resurrection to all who rest in you, that your light may shine in their lives and from there out to others. Jesus, Saviour. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the Father, full of the Spirit, hear our prayers, receive our praises, fill our lives. Amen. And so if you are able, let's join together in bringing all our prayers together, those that are said and unsaid, in the words that our Saviour taught us, and the words will be on the screen. So let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom's king, the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Our next reading is taken from Matthew 2, the first verse. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had given, seen in the east, went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and incense and of myrrh. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We have heard some great truths from God's word already this evening. And with that in mind, we're going to take a few moments now to reflect on all we've heard about the baby that was born that first Christmas. We've got a short video to watch now, because he is not just a baby.
He's just a baby, 10 fingers, 10 toes, 2 eyes, 2 ears, 1 mouth and 1 nose. He's just a baby, cries out for mum's arms as he lies in a manger in the innkeeper's barn. He's just a baby, yet the sky changed its form as a new star appeared when this baby was born. He's just a baby, yet the hosts of heaven sang hallelujah to this baby, hallelujah, Son of Man. He's just a baby, yet drove a mad king wild, who stained the streets with innocence, looking for this child. Why? Because he's just a baby, yet will walk on the seas, feed thousands with nothing, and perform miracles with ease. He's just a baby, yet will carry out the law, live a life of perfection so man will fear no more. He's just a baby, yet will speak to every nation, every broken heart and lost soul, he will fight for their salvation. He's just a baby, yet when they call him man, they will shout for crucifixion and drive nails through his hands. He's just a baby, yet at his final breath, all creation will shake, mourning his death. He's just a baby, yet when he's laid in his grave, he will rise 3 days later, victorious to save. He is just a baby, when we look in his festive cot. But the truth is, he's not just a baby. He is the Almighty Son of God.
Before we sing our next carol, which tells you what Christianity is all about in a single song, if anything you've seen or heard this evening has struck you and you'd like to chat more, we'd love to do that. If you don't get to me or Wendy after the service, do be in touch with the parish office. If you don't want to chat, but if you do want to think more, please do take one of these on the way out. There is no charge for them. Read it through in your own time. This is a really great little leaflet to show us more of what Christmas is really about and the gift God's given us in Jesus. And don't forget to join us at all our other Christmas services and events over the next week or so. And finally, the very best way we think you could explore more with us about Christmas and Easter and Christianity in the new year is to join us for 3 evenings. And do please take one of these. It is a really short course, only 3 weeks, looking at how Christianity offers real hope, real peace, real purpose for life. And isn't that something we're all looking for? Hope, peace, and purpose. And of course, we meet here every Sunday at 10:45, and at other times in our 3 churches across the parish. Our website has got all the details you need, or do get in touch with the parish office. I think we're going to stand. I think we're going to sing our next hymn now, our next carol now.
Thank you. The sixth reading is from John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
please do take a seat. We've come now to the end of this year's carol service. Thank you so much for joining us here this evening. We look forward very much to seeing you at some of the other services and events that we have on over Christmas and then on into the new year. There will be an opportunity on your way out to make a donation if you would like to do that. And the monies this evening will be that are collected here will be split between two charities, the Hospice in the Weald and Rock UK. If you don't know who Rock UK are, they are a Christian charity providing outdoor adventure at nationwide centres. And we have one here in Tunbridge called Carity Wood. So that's the Hospice in the Weald and Rock UK, if you would like to donate to those. Do stay after the service for refreshments. If you make your way to the back of the church as we close, there will be one of our wonderful volunteers to direct you towards mulled wine and mince pies. We'd love you to stay with us for those after the service. May I take this opportunity on behalf of Ben and myself and the whole team here at St. Peter and St. Paul to wish you a very happy and peace-filled Christmas. So let's hold a moment's quiet before I share a prayer as we close. May God the Father, who loved the world so much that he sent his only Son, give you grace to prepare for life eternal. May God the Son, who comes to us as Redeemer and Judge, reveal to you the path from darkness to light. And may God the Holy Spirit, by whose working the Virgin Mary conceived the Christ, help you bear the fruits of holiness. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you this Christmas time and forevermore. Amen.